our innovation center, I'm absolutely in awe of the amazing Africans who've been involved in designing and developing and making these things real. And you know what? Every single bit of this technology is homegrown. These are Africans that have done this. What you see here is world class.
Why do you think the continent has not managed to play a bigger role in aerospace?
Frankly, nobody set their mind to it, and nobody set their mind to putting all these amazing people together to go out and do it, and we decided to do that now.
We operate in Asia, we operate in Eastern Europe, we operate in South America, and we're a real example of how African technology, African capability can be exported throughout the world.
Paramount Group, leaders in defense and security innovation.
First, let me introduce Masoud Sharif Mahmoud, who's chief executive of Yasat, to come to the platform to introduce Buzz. And remember, keep those messages coming through so that I have plenty to put to Buzz shortly here on the platform.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Your Excellencies, esteemed officials, colleagues, and honorable guests. I would like to welcome you here to the second day of the Global Aerospace Summit. It is a pleasure and a privilege to be speaking to you today, and we are honored by the attendance of a true space pioneer, Dr. Buzz Aldrin. Dr. Aldrin is one of the world's most decorated astronauts, having locked 12 days, 1 hour, and 52 minutes in space while on the Gemini 12 and Apollo 11 missions. But what he is most famous for, and what all of us know him for, is being the second human being to step foot on the surface of the moon. Dr. Aldrin is a living legend to many of us here. While many of us here were either too young to remember, or even were not born at the time, I'm sure all of us would recognize the famous black and white footage of the first human moon landing in history of mankind. A moment that has changed mankind's perception about space and about scientific discovery thereafter. More than four decades forward, and space is no longer an untamed or untouched frontier. Remarkable achievements and scientific breakthroughs that have been achieved could only be achieved through a combination of dedication, passion, discovery, a sense of adventure, a lot of hard work and sweat, but most important of all, vision and imagination. At around the same time when Dr. Aldrin walked on the surface of the moon to fulfill the vision of space exploration, the United Arab Emirates was just formed as a nation. Yet here we are today, with three homegrown satellite companies and a combined fleet of 9 satellites, including future announced programs and existing ones, proud to have become the region's hub for satellite innovation. Yasat played a significant role in the UAE space journey. As the region's first multi-mission satellite operator, we have pioneered new business models with technologies serving both commercial and government needs, allowing us to bring connectivity to more than 1 billion people in the Middle East, Africa, and Southwest Asia. We believe our services play an integral part in developing communities and helping them prosper through the power of connection, empowering them to compete and thrive economically. There are no better examples than the work that we've done in rural Pakistan, where Yaklik, Yasa's satellite broadband product, was used to connect an herbal central hospital with a few dozen remote healthcare facilities, giving rural patients access to wider medical care infrastructure. In neighboring Afghanistan, we have installed a few hundred sites to provide connectivity services to the Ministry of Interior National ID Registration Project throughout the country. Across another continent in Africa, Yaklik was also used for connecting rural healthcare clinics in Kenya, a service that would have been near impossible with conventional terrestrial methods. We truly feel privileged to work in a unique industry that can transform societies by accelerating economic growth, an industry that enables young people to dream, an industry that provides a platform for future innovation. And on that, and on the human talent front, Yasat is proud of its commitment to the development of Emirati talent. Over the last few years, we have developed national talent as satellite engineers, as satellite operators, as RF and baseband engineers, as satellite system designers, flight dynamic engineers, software programmers, working on fun and innovative developments who are contributing significant value to the organization and the country. We're hoping, and in fact, we are betting on the prospect that these innovations and the talent behind them will be a stepping stone and a platform for future innovation and development here in the UAE, much like Dr. Aldrin and his fellow astronauts' expeditions into space was the stepping stone and the platform for space and planetary discovery. One important factor, and another crucial factor, is that the enabler of this global journey into space has been the support of governments across the world. Governments, although uncertain about the future returns socially, scientifically, commercially from such ventures, still pursued the impossible, eventually creating an industry that not only brought about great technological advancements, but also helped create a whole ecosystem of scientists and engineers who are an important platform for future growth and development. I would like to welcome our honorable guest, Dr. Buzz Aldrin, astronaut of the Apollo 11 Gemini 12 space missions, to share his unique insights and space about space exploration. But before that, I believe we have a 3-minute video that sets the scene for that. Thank you.
We choose to go to the moon because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept and one we intend to win.
T-minus 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence starts. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running.
Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
Curiosity of all mankind to explore the unknown. Good morning. I'd like to thank Mubabala, Ahmed, Homaid, your royal highnesses and distinguished guests for having me to speak at the Global Aerospace Summit. I like the way it says Global Aerospace Summit because I've been using a possible term as an individual as being a global space statesman. And it fits in well, I think, with your conference and with many. Because I believe that global cooperation, and I think now is the time to get the world together, working together in space. I see only advantages for both the United States and the rest of the world. And now is the time to do something about it. I also believe that commercial investment plays a crucial role in the future development of space as it transitions from government to commercial to private sector. Arthur C. Clarke, good friend of mine, once famously said that the Cold War created an artificial salient into space created by governments. The real question for the future is whether productive commercial activities can fill that salient before it collapses. I firmly believe that the last few years have shown that commercial investment is finally ready to fill that salient. And I stand before you here today because I believe that the United Arab Emirates will play a role in this commercial development of space. Indeed, many of you here today already are investing heavily in space. Timing is very important and has always been a key element in my life. I've been very blessed to have been at the right place, at the right time. So many times, it's astonishing. Education, a strong work ethic, a supportive family, and a sense of adventure were also important factors. I am very proud to have served my country, both in the United States Air Force and in the Apollo program. I like being a part, a team player of a winning team. West Point has lost many previous games to Navy, and I hope we can do something about that. When people work together, you can sometimes accomplish the end of the impossible. Apollo could never have happened without the cooperation and efforts of many people working together for a shared goal. What we accomplished within a decade was unprecedented, but I know with determination and the will, we can do great things again. Consider this: mankind has dreamed for centuries of reaching space, the moon, and even the stars. But it wasn't until the 20th century that man took his first powered flight in 1903 on a windy morning. Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, the Wright brothers and their flyer took their first flight defying gravity. My mother, Marion Moon, was born that same year. Only 66 years later, Neil and I stepped on the moon, fulfilling the dreams of millions of people around the Earth. I'll share a little bit of the story of how we got there and how when we work together, the world can achieve the next impossible dream. And then I'll tell you a little bit about my plans for our future in space. In 1961, NASA launched America's first Mercury astronaut, Alan Shepard, on a 15-minute suborbital flight that touched the edge of space. This was the start of an impressive catch-up process. The Russians had already achieved an incredible achievement by sending, after Sputnik, the first human into space, cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, for one full orbit around the Earth. But everyone wondered, what's next? President Kennedy asked NASA and its ranks of engineers and rocket scientists, led by Wernher von Braun, what was possible. They told him that it would take at least 15 years before we could put a man on the moon. Now, instead of accepting what was possible, on May 25th, 1961, just 3 weeks after Alan Shepard's flight, President Kennedy boldly challenged America to commit to the goal of landing a man on the moon before the end of the decade. We'd not even put a man into orbit. The rockets and spacecraft needed to go beyond Earth orbit didn't exist. Many thought the challenge to be impossible. We really didn't have the know-how, but we did have a leader with the vision, the determination, the courage, and the confidence that we could get there. By publicly stating our goal and putting a specific time period on a very specific accomplishment, President Kennedy gave us no escape, no back door. And I believe that a future leader could have the vision, the determination, and the courage to make this kind of a commitment again. Only this time to go beyond the moon. A little bit more involved commitment. Now, if space was going to be our next frontier, then I wanted to be a part of getting there. This was before. After I completed my tour of duty in Germany, patrolling the border and then on 5-minute alert with nuclear weapons, I decided to continue my education and eventually to receive my doctorate in astronautics from MIT. My father was one of the first to complete his doctorate in the aeronautics program in the early 20s, around 1920. For my thesis, I adapted my experience as a fighter pilot intercepting enemy aircraft, or strafing, or bombing, or just landing. I took that experience that requires setting up to be in the right place to devise a technique for two spacecraft, one-man spacecraft, to meet in space called Manned Orbital Rendezvous. Little did anyone know, including me, just how critical this work would be to our successful landing on the moon and coming back. The first time I applied to be a NASA astronaut in 1962, I was turned down because I had not had test pilot training. That was not on my program to just look at perfection for the present time. I knew there were great pilot candidates who could get into an airplane and feel at home immediately. It took a little time for me, but when I did have that little time, I was pretty good. During the Korean War, I shot down two MiG-15s. So I was determined to apply again in 1963. This time, my jet fighter experience and NASA's interest in my concept for space rendezvous influenced them to accept me in the third group of astronauts, where I became known by my astronaut peers as Dr. Rendezvous. John Hubolt, a very clever NASA engineer, figured out that if we used two specialized spacecraft to go to the moon, one, a command and service module, to remain in orbit around the moon once it got there, and then an ascent and descent stage of a lunar module to land, leave the descent stage, ascent stage comes up, and rendezvous with the command and service module. Then the ascent stage is left at the moon. Then the rocket needed to land. Many parts of this could be significantly smaller, including the landing rocket. They didn't need to be so big, and they could be left on the surface or in lunar orbit. Now, this is where my MIT rendezvous studies really paid off. Sure, we knew how to rendezvous in Earth orbit from the Gemini program, in practice, in a way, for rendezvousing at the moon, which with all the help we had and the training turned out to be not as difficult as a lot of people really thought. So the critical key to our approach to the moon would be our ability to reliably rendezvous two spacecraft around the moon. Dangerous, yes. If it failed, there wasn't any way to rescue the astronauts in the ascent stage. But the command module could also do a rendezvous. They didn't have to in case one failure in the lunar module. Luckily, my MIT work was what we needed to be developed in the Gemini program. And then after that, the timing of crew rotation was just right for three of us. Neil Armstrong, Michael Collins, and me to be chosen as the crew for the historic mission to be the first to land on the moon. There's a little piece of trivia that I won't go into right now, but it initially was not going to work out that way. But fate comes in and makes some changes, and I had a lot of fate working for me. Now, the entire 8-day round-trip mission of the three of us We lived in a space capsule about the size of an automobile, a Volkswagen automobile. Shortly after launch, we fired the Saturn V third stage engines, and now that accelerated us from 17,000 miles an hour to 25,000 miles an hour, put us on a trajectory, actually a free return trajectory, toward the moon. And then on day three, we fired the service module engine to slow us down enough for the moon's gravity to capture us and put us into lunar orbit. Another engine burn put us into an orbit that then had the right altitude above the moon to begin the powered descent. Now, the three of us obviously did a lot of barroom talking about what's the chance that we might be successful in landing and coming back. The calculation of the success of landing was not part of the specs that went into the performance of the many, many objects needed to bring us back safely. So we did agree that 60% the chance of landing, because we could abort without landing and still make it back. And we really believed, because we were told to believe, and we really did, why not, believe that we had a 95% chance of returning home safely. I liked that 95%. That sounded pretty good. Not that the kind of reliability that we heard for passenger travel yesterday, 10 to the 6th or something. We didn't know what that meant. Now, as I stepped onto the talcum powder-like lunar dust, technically called regolith, the first words that came to my mind was magnificent desolation. It was a magnificent accomplishment for humans, for man, to set foot on another world for the first time. Magnificent. And yet there was the desolation of the million-year-old landscape that hasn't changed. No sign of life, no atmosphere. Total blackness beyond the sunlit horizon, where you could clearly see a large boulder or something that was right on the horizon. Now, this is a photograph that Neil took of me, and because of the reflection in the visor where you can see the spacecraft, and you can see Neil all reflected in the visor. People have asked me why this particular iconic picture is so great. I have three words: location, location, location. Since our splashdown in the Pacific, I've come to realize that more than the rocks we brought back or the experiments that we left, the true value of Apollo is the amazing story of innovation and teamwork that went into overcoming all the obstacles to reach the moon. That effort was driven in part by competition, but in part scientific discovery, and just to demonstrate to our people and the people of the world that we had the qualities to carry out that mission. Everyone on Earth, as we toured around different countries, felt that they had participated in this incredible journey. We saw signs out there, and they didn't say, "You did it." They said, "We did it." And they really felt that this incredible journey, as we arrived and walked on another celestial body for the first time in the history of mankind, that the world achieved that. And the world welcomed us back from the moon as heroes. However, I really understood that they were not cheering for three guys, but for what we represented. That by a nation and the world coming together, we'd accomplish the impossible. The commemorative plaque that we left on the lunar surface reads, "Here men from the planet Earth first set foot upon the moon, July 1969. We came in peace for all mankind." And this, I think, has been the spirit of the NASA space program, especially the human space program. And I truly believe that mankind's next accomplishment in space will truly involve global participation. No single nation can accomplish this alone. To be successful, it will take cooperation across more than national borders. It'll take cooperation across industrial sectors, scientific disciplines, and even public policy stovepipes. In short, we will take what I call a unified space vision. President Bush had a vision for space exploration, but space is more than that. It's a vision which combines exploration, science, development, commercial, and security. Education crosses all of those, not in one specific area. So my main purpose here today is to talk about my unified space vision, which outlines my plans for the future, and in particular, how to use the moon as a stepping stone to Mars. And that stepping stone doesn't necessarily include landing again. It includes a lot of assisting, of leading by not going back and assisting the other nations. And I consider that this will enhance international cooperation. And as I mentioned earlier, I consider myself a global statesman for space. And I've been doing the best to get the world interested again so that we can move our achievements forward. People ask me all the time, why do we need to go to Mars? Or why do we even need a space program? Because basically by venturing into space, we, internationally humans, improve life for everyone here on Earth. The scientific advancement and innovation that come from this type of research create products and technology we use in our daily lives and provide even more convenience for people all over the world. For example, cell phones, TV, GPS. I've got two of them. One of them is adaptable for satellite communications, of course. All of these would not have been possible without investments here and there in the space program. So how do we get people excited? The big question is, how do we get there? We need a plan. We also need a leader in the world to state a public goal and a specific time. I've got ideas, of course, as to how that commitment should be declared around the 50th anniversary of humans' first landing on the moon, and that'll be in July of 2019. But I've also laid out a plan in my new book entitled Mission to Mars. Now, I wanted to put an S on the end of that, making it missions, because it certainly isn't one mission. And it is my vision for space exploration. It was produced by National Geographic. We're talking about multiple missions to settle and colonize Mars, not just go there and come back. To some, it may sound like science fiction, but that's what people thought when Kennedy made the commitment to go to the moon. Years ago, I devised a method of cycling orbits on spacecraft on continuous trajectories, passing by the Earth, but 5-6 months later, passing by Mars, and then coming back to complete the 26 months when Earth has a launch window for going to Mars. So let me show you what I mean, and I'll explain how Purdue University is playing a role in my vision. What does a cycler look like? We have a wonderful rotating version of this. And we also have a video animation, but this one was developed by a new video game entitled Buzz Aldrin's Space Program Manager. Gives you an idea of what the Aldrin cycler could look like. It'll probably change as new technologies evolve, but this is the first stab at it. It's really two Mars exploration spacecraft put together. And I've made some changes already. Now there's another animation that is very nice to look at because it explains not just the 26 month of one synodic period, but of two synodic periods. So you need two cyclers and they alternate. And from this starting position, a trajectory goes and reaches Mars, wings by Mars, and the lander gets off. Really, all we need to join up with this is the lander. Now, for other details that you can think about, this is not a free return trajectory. It's a very time critical, and instead of one lander, we're going to have two landers on sort of twin rocket systems. Never been done before. Now, this is my unified space vision chart. On the previous slide, swinging by Mars goes outside, Mars comes back, goes outside again, comes back, swings by the Earth. The Earth turns its energy level, and for a year and a half, it comes back to Earth again. And it is much, much superior to the Aldrin cycler. So it's the Purdue Aldrin cycler system. Now this time clock of years, of course, clocks go this way. Most of you know that orbits go this way. This is a little hard for me to really understand because it doesn't really give you the concept of what is really happening. And I've improved on a concept that I submitted in 2009. which showed a number of things leading up to occupying the moon of Mars, Phobos, and then from there building the facilities on the surface. Then a cycler delivers people to the surface of Mars where they stay. That you'll see further motion of this on my website as long as, along with the progression of missions with time, for you going this way with time, and the progression of missions leading through the moon to the activities at Mars. And that'll be updated as I've updated it here in the last few days. But it'll show up on my website also. Now, Chinese cooperation in international lunar development will be tremendously enhanced by Chinese participation in the International Space Station. That has been disapproved. We need to change that. And we need to have international activities at the Chinese space station's inclination of 42 degrees. Now, we need to re-invite China's participation in the International Space Station. Is there a precedent for that? You bet there is. In 1975, when the Cold War was really pretty active, Soviet Union and the United States saw fit to have an Apollo rendezvous with Soyuz. I don't think anyone thinks that that was a bad maneuver. That was a good maneuver. And that, in 1975, the 40th anniversary of that will come in July 2015. 1 year following the 40th anniversary of our first reaching the moon. And this can bring nations together for an international lunar-based authority or lunar development authority, patterned after a little bit Intelsat. We may have inflatable or rigid modules evaluated at this 42 degrees, and then we'll begin to implement, maybe rigid on the surface, maybe inflatable en route. The U.S. position at the moon to lead in lunar activities will be enhanced by not competing, but instead putting two Mars spacecraft at the libration points on the far side and the near side, 50,000 miles away, 40,000. And as the moon moves around the Earth, so do these libration points. And we'll use those to develop science and commercial robotic activities, developing the resources, especially the ice crystals, water, and we can then launch those into orbit to the near side of the moon, where we'll establish a fuel depot. The human to Mars transportation system can be initially underway by 2030. We can replace the asteroid retrieval mission of 2021 with a dual robotic and human mission arriving at an asteroid together in 2025. I really firmly believe that that's the best way. Planetary defense should be led against impacts by the highest level of national security of the combined nations with their international capabilities. Commercial resources should be investigated, developed first on the moon, robotically and with human assistance, before proceeding to serious asteroid resource. Humans to Mars planned permanence from the first sortie to the surface to a rather complete Mars operations complex assembled by the Mars moon Phobos by international crews. In 1985, I started my Share Space Foundation to lobby for a lottery to give people a chance to go into space. It wouldn't be something that just the governments or the rich could do. But now, companies like Virgin Galactic, X-Corp, Blue Origin are starting to become a reality. And X-Corp in particular has a program of selecting people that makes my lottery look like amateur. It's very, very well done internationally. And people can start having test suborbital flights on this system in this year and taking people on suborbital flights in 2015. So I am the AXE, Apollo Space Ambassador. AXE makes me smell nice. It's made by the Unilever company, which is international. And as the ambassador, last December, we gave away 22 suborbital flights to winners from all over the world. So I don't have to do my lottery anymore. And I'm very excited to see the dream of space tourism really come to fruition in many ways. I think the most significant departure that I take from current space architecture is to remove the emphasis of the United States going back to the moon. It's expensive, we did it before, and we already blazed that trail. It's time for commercial, international interest to move beyond discovery to development. Other nations are developing the capability to explore and develop the moon with robots and eventually crews. I'm sure way off in the future we'll have crews there too, but the most important is to stepping stones to become pioneers with the transportation system to Mars. And we'll be supporting international lunar developments to help them and to help us. It's very nice the way I've arranged this. By participating in an international program, we avoid a race back to the moon and we facilitate long-term international cooperation. And this approach retains our ability to participate in lunar science exploration development with other U.S. government authorities, National Science Foundation, and different scientific academies. And it may well be that NASA is not the best agency to exploit space. Exploitation has maybe never been its strong point. We should carefully consider when and how lunar transitions to other commercial interests and to U.S. government agencies more adept at identifying, exploiting scientific opportunities. My son, very talented, smarter than I, earns more money than I do, has left his position with United Launch Alliance and is now president of Moon Express. My main focus is Mars, but importantly, getting beyond Earth orbit. I've always felt that Mars should be the next destination following our landings on the moon, and I've been very vocal about it for a long time. But the dream of reaching Mars looks like it's getting closer together. Things like the Curiosity rover has taught us a lot about descent and will teach us more and more since its main purpose is science investigation, showing us more than we've ever known before. Humans inherently have a need to explore, push beyond current limits, just like we were able to do 45 years ago. Apollo is the story of people at their best working together for a common goal. We started with a dream. We can do these kinds of things again. I know, because I'm living proof that it can be done. So we invite you all to the impossible dream. Thank you very much.
Buzz, thank you very much indeed, please.
Thank you. Did I cut into your time?
That's no problem.
No problem.
It's their time. And they've made time to come and listen to you, so that's fine. I'm still struck by the quality of those images on the Hasselblad camera, I think it was, back in 45 years ago. Now we take for granted the GoPro and the digital technology and the speed at which everything could be broadcast back to Earth. That had to be hand carried back with you in the module.
The film packs, not the camera.
That's what I mean. I should tell you that he has a tie here, which the camera won't be able to pick out, but it's got the insignia of every manned mission, Gemini.
And Apollo.
And every Apollo mission. I don't know if the camera can pick it out. He did tell me he hasn't dry cleaned it yet. Buzz, let me pick up. We've got a few questions here, not a lot of time. Jenny Welsh from Mubadala, what was the backup plan in case the LEM couldn't take off after the moon landing? What was plan B?
There's a certain amount of oxygen on board.
And?
Some of it's in the backpacks. And if you have any suspicion, maybe you don't take them off and open up the hatch and throw them overboard. You'd use every bit of oxygen you have, and then you just fall asleep. We don't have another lander ready to go right away.
So there was only one option.
You're not going to land the command and service module on the moon. You need power to the descent stage. And that goes through a circuit breaker called the engine arm circuit breaker. And if it broke off, as it did, we got to push that back in again somehow.
I was very struck by that 95% probability. I think many of the things we do in our daily lives have a probability which is far less than 95%. So you are a pretty good wicket there.
Well, some of us are in combat. And depending on what kind of support we have in combat for security, our odds may be a little less than that.
When you were flying your 66 missions in Korea, was your probability much lower than 95%?
We were pretty good. We had a very good airplane developed, the Sabre jet. And it had advantages. The MiG had advantages at high level, but our training was much higher for the pilots than their training was for the Russian, Chinese, or North Korean. I think most of them were Russian pilots.
Let me pick up on a number of those issues that you've raised. Michael Dennis, do you believe the global collaboration between countries on space exploration bonds people and cultures, breaking down historical differences, is a greater outcome achieved? Because you've already talked about the need and the possibilities, but what we're seeing now is a great Chinese push, we're seeing an Indian push, we're seeing the Russians spending more on defense, and one doesn't know what's going on in their program in terms of cash flow, and at the same time, there's a pullback from the American operations.
I wouldn't really say there's a pullback. There's not the same enthusiasm at higher levels in executive branch and in Congress.
But there's less cash being made available.
We needed 3.5-4% of the available budget in 1967, 8, and 9 during the peak, we're getting 0.5%. Our objectives are not matched by our ability to do things. And people have told me, geez, you got to go out and champion. Let's raise the NASA budget. You got to have an objective, and you have to have a policy that's clear before people are going to increase the budget.
But picking up on Michael's point, is it about global collaboration on these projects, or is it now about global national sovereign rivalry, particularly from the Chinese, who after all have very significant resource and determination?
Well, I think we need to remove the obstacles that we have set up to cooperation with the Chinese. And I don't think we have to open the doors to everything. My limitation would be above the atmosphere and civil and commercial cooperation, not military defense, reconnaissance, or guidance for ballistic missiles. Let's get to the cooperative things that can be symbolic to nations coming together, all of them up here. Then some of that cooperation will drift down to the terrestrial difficulties that exist on human rights violations, aggressiveness toward islands in the South China Sea for resources, and for a culture in the Far East that copies things.
Let me just ask.
Computer and internet, you can copy all sorts of things if you can find them. They may belong to somebody else.
Let me just find out, would anyone like to ask a question? I want to get the microphone to you. I can't actually see you, but raise a piece of paper or something if you'd like to ask a question. If there's anyone out there, we have some lights now. I've got plenty of other questions I can ask, but please raise a piece of paper or just get the microphone to you in the next 5 or 6 minutes. Over there, please.
Some of the clarifying things will come from the website, www.buzzaldrin.com.
So open up your tablets and smartphones. A microphone there. But let me just keep pressing you on what you said about commercial international interests. Your son is president of Moon Express. What's the profit and loss account going to look like? When do you start making a profit on these kind of commercial operations? How much is going to be spent? After all, national interests, sovereign governments, can make an absolute commitment like Kennedy did, like the Chinese and Indians are doing at the moment.
Well,
that is written off.
What was the payoff from Kennedy's commitment? And the scientists gave the NASA administrator a number to go to the president. On the way over to the White House, he doubled that number. And with that number, we came in under budget and on time.
But that was from a national interest.
But Apollo didn't make any money for the government. We hired different companies to build things, and they made profits. They did very well. They inspired a new nation of engineers and technicians. There was no word in the 60s and 70s like STEM.
What
education,
is
science, technology, engineering, and math.
What I'm trying to get to, what is the business model in your mind for commercial international interests when it's not being funded by a national government with a national budget?
Well, I wish I had the resources to design exactly what launch vehicle are going to be needed to carry out the transportation. I'm a transportation person, and many different rockets, and their prices are varying. I don't believe that landing on Mars is going to be a private venture. It could be, you know. We've done things like that on Earth in the past, but their payoff hasn't been, they've been pretty expensive. And I think it's a little difficult to land people on the moon and get a financial return from it. It's what you develop as the result of doing that. Your stature in the international community, And what that leads to in inspiration and advancing technology in many areas is where the payoff is. And in my case, landing human beings on the moon, establishing a permanence there, is so important in the history of humanity here on Earth that I think the commitment by a world leader, by a person who has enough to see it done privately, those people, names will be remembered for hundreds and thousands of years into the future.
Well,
and some people, some leaders want that.
I'm going to ask at the end if anyone wants to invest on putting a base on the moon. And I'll ask at the end.
The moon.
If anyone, but there's a hand's gone up. I'll come to you in a moment. Get the microphone to that gentleman as well. But I'm going to come to you first, please. Anyone else want to come in?
Because if I had the money, I don't think I'd look for a return on investment.
You have a potential backer.
Specifically.
Someone's just put their hand up. So I'm going to go to him in a moment, please.
Good morning. First, I would like to thank the organizer, mainly Mubadala, for inviting a celebrity such Dr. Buzz. You are welcome in the United Arab Emirates. The question is, do you have any cooperation with Elon Musk, the X-Space founder, and I believe he is pursuing the mission to Mars? And I'm sure that the private sector now will have to support these missions, because I don't think so the government are at this stage capable to continue supporting such mission. Thank you.
He's referring to SpaceX and the chairman, Elon Musk, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. I've talked to Elon on many occasions about the knowledge that I've accumulated by going to the moon and by going to planning for many years how to achieve human landings on Mars. He doesn't want to hear it. He's got his own ideas. We got a rocket, we got a spacecraft, we're going to land on Mars. At first, he talked about tourism. That means bringing people back. I don't think he understands the difficulties of that. I think he does now, and he wants to live on Mars, maybe. The past history of that organization that was broke. Tesla was broke. The rockets were broke after three failures. Things came along and people helped him, and now he has a roaring success in Tesla and a improving success with the Falcon and the Falcon Heavy. There's still obstacles to be overcome, and he's doing everything, rockets and spacecraft,
with a big investment.
Missions, and I said, well, here's a mission that we thought we could inspire people, and I'm talking about people who might invest, and
right.
He said, we don't need any money, we have all we need.
When I asked, and this is the last question, who was it who put up their hand, saying you, right, you have the microphone, that's even better. The last intervention, Buzz, before we have to hand on to John Quesada, I said, who would like to invest in a space program? You put up your hand, please. Why? How much money?
Well, let me just say that the business case is not defined by what your immediate return is, but your business case is defined by the generations that benefit from it. So if we go back to the moon and try to define the business case for the moon, you wouldn't find that anybody would say that there's a profitable reason to go to the moon. But the capital that was gained by that exploration, both in human capital and business capital, has been almost unimaginable. So that's the reason why I would invest to go to Mars and go back to the moon.
How much money would you put on the table?
Wait a minute, there's several things he can invest in. Short-term investment, getting into orbits, reusable.
Are you specific about what you'd invest in?
What I would invest all of my capital.
All of your capital in going to Mars?
You bet.
You have a commitment today. There you are.
I'll do it. I'll sign up with Buzz any day.
Ask him if he has a business card.
I think we'd better get the MOU drafted before the end of this session, in case he changes his mind. But what do you say to that, that kind of commitment, that there is someone interested, at least in principle, in public, to say something like that? Or do you get many commitments like that?
It's pretty hard to contribute to the Treasury of the United States. If you can find the different ways of doing that that appear to be very promising, and if they're operating on a shoestring, they may need some assistance to make what they're doing more effective. And I think becoming a part of a team on a winning method of doing something is a great historical place to be. The president, our president, will be needed to make a commitment, as would the leader of any other country would need to make a commitment. And if it's as big a thing as humanity, establishing a growing colony on another planet, I've given a lot of thought to that.
Right.
And that is a big deal, a very big deal in the history of humankind.
Buzz, just as a footnote, you brought out two mobile phones in your pocket. Do you have more processing power in your pocket today than you had on your Apollo flight?
Well, I could call one of them the command module and the other one the lunar module.
You've made my point.
And if I toss both of them up in the air, they're not going to rendezvous.